WTBQ.
Good morning, folks. This is Jeff Berkman, your host on the Wednesday Roundtable, and on Orange Free Radio, free for you to express your opinions. As per usual, I got a lot on my mind. I hope we're technologically up to speed here, because I don't really hear my voice like I usually do. But Frank says everything's all right. There we go. Something just clicked on. So, clicked off again. Anyway, there we go. I think I'm set now. How about you guys?
Good.
Everybody's
check,
good?
Check, yep.
All right, good. Very good. So, getting a jumpy start here. At any rate, I'm delighted I have two guests with me this morning who I met yesterday when I went to the Hoboken Film Festival at Greenwood Lake, of course. And I don't know if you guys know this, but before that it was in Middletown. That was kind of my introduction to the Dalvecchio Hoboken thing, because the film festival, after it left Hoboken, it went to Middletown, New York for 3 years. And then after that, it went to Greenwood Lake. So I saw an excellent movie yesterday with my wife, Adrian. And the name of it is 21 Years, A Folded Flag. And the two gentlemen that put this together are here with me today. And the story, basically, well, I'll let Michael explain where the, Richard Fitz,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Junior.
Yep.
Right, because it's relevant because there's a senior as well, and it's sort of your story and your dad's story and a family story, which kind of is America's story in some ways.
Yeah, it's very true. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and then, I'm sorry, sir, I don't know your name.
Rudy. Rudy Childs.
Rudy Childs.
I'm the producer.
Producer. So yeah. We have the director, star, and the producer.
Star is a relative word. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll come to what a producer does in just a moment. But yep. First, let's go to Richard. Richard, why don't you give it a nutshell? I mean, I could read it, but it'd be better if you explained exactly what the movie's about.
Well, my father, when I was very young, my father was always considered missing in action. And for 21 plus
years. This is, pardon me, from the Vietnam War.
From the Vietnam era war, yes. And my father was missing in action for over 21 years. And we had no true information about really what happened. And that's really where the movie, what takes place. We kind of explain what happened when I was little. And basically start from there, try to fill in all the gaps in the middle. It's kind of my journey of about finding out exactly what happened to my father.
Right.
And through this journey is basically how we told the story, and it came together and kind of unfolded as we went through this.
Right. Interesting. I'm already making a correction on something I've said, even though we just started. I said the Vietnam War. It was actually the Indochina War, because that becomes...
technically, yeah.
Because, of course, most people just call it the Vietnam War, but that's a relevant fact because your dad was missing in action from Laos, right?
Yes. Laos was a denied area. They were claiming that they were politically neutral.
Right.
This is where a lot of the controversy comes across, is because, you know, the general public will hear that and say, well, they're saying they're neutral. What a lot of people didn't understand is at the time, Laos and Cambodia and areas that were claiming that they were neutral were actually supplying our enemies, allowing all these supply routes and everything else, among many other things, to go on through the Ho Chi Minh Trail complex.
Right.
And so we had to figure out a way to interdict that.
Right, I remember, I'm a little bit older than you guys, and I was like 16 or 17 when the war widened, and here we thought it was kind of narrowing down, right? But instead, we found out it was Operation Parrot's Beak, which was the expansion of the war into Cambodia, which
right.
also was
right.
sort of neutral, I'll say.
Right.
And Laos was the other sort of neutral country.
Right.
It was like those governments didn't really have control over their own countries in a way. Like independent bands could rove around, and North Vietnamese could kind of penetrate at will.
Right.
And then have sanctuary there. And then if America went in there to beat them up, there'd be protests about how we were violating neutrality.
Right. Yep.
It was kind of a one-way street towards compliance.
Exactly. Yeah.
I remember that. I have a friend of mine who actually was injured in Cambodia during that action.
Mm-hmm.
But so you were only 2 years old? Is that when you're...
Yes. When it all came down where my father met his demise, I was only 2 years old.
And, of course, that's a huge impact on your life. And your grandfather also was a significant influence on the film as well.
Yes, yeah, actually, I mean, in my life, you know, especially my father's father, but, you know, even my mother's grandfather, in a way, was an influence to a point. I mean, they were both World War II veterans, you know, so there were certain things, you know. Of course, my father's father and that side of the family, you know, they kept that candle burning and trying to find out exactly what happened.
Right, because you couldn't get information. It was all classified. That comes out... as clear as a bell in the movie.
Yes, right.
The frustration that all of your family members and you specifically had in trying to, you know, find out about the last days of your dad's life and they just kind of shut you down.
Well, it's the proof that you wanted, you know. For years there was just no proof. And, you know, it was all a big mystery.
Right.
As I explained in the movie, you know.
Now, where did you two meet and how did you get involved being the producer?
I had been producing some rock and roll documentaries, and Richard came to one of my screenings, and that's how our relationship began. But prior to that, it was actually my family was friends with Richard's father's parents.
Oh, okay.
So I had known about the Fitz's family from the 80s. And we lived one town from each other up in Massachusetts, and I moved away into the D.C. area in 70s, 79, and I would come back and I would always know about this family, the Fitz. But as I lived down in D.C., when I would visit the Vietnam Memorial Wall, that was the name I knew.
Right.
I always visited that name on the wall for years, and then I never knew that I would take, you know, have such an undertaking to produce a powerful documentary like we did with Richard,
right,
about his family.
Interesting. I was in Washington D.C. that same time in 79. I was going to school there.
To tell him about the actual details about how we met. Again, as you can see, this common denominator through the music business. We had, you know, different friends and stuff like that, and. I was introduced to him in person, and he literally said to me, he's like, Rudy, this is Richard Fitz Jr. And he says, are you related to the Fitz in Abington that was you know, missing for 21 years? And kind of, yeah. I'm
Abington,
only son.
Massachusetts,
yeah. Right. And Rudy can help fill in some of this. This is really crazy. It's just one of those things that kind of happens. I wasn't really necessarily setting out to do a documentary, but I needed help to try to start preserving all the stuff that I had, and even from my grandparents' stuff that was handed down after they passed, and all this. Rudy living in the Maryland area, when did you, it was like early 90s, like 90, 91.
Right.
When, you know, after my father's funeral, after everything was kind of settled in a way.
Well, the government gave more information in order to have
it leaked out here and there. But anyway, he had done a film for my grandparents. A long time before I even met him.
Right, because they had a mass burial for the soldiers that were lost on that mission in Arlington. And I went down there and visited the grave and filmed it. And then I had sent a film back to my sister, who gave it to my parents, who then gave it to Richard's grandparents. And, you know, so that was, you know, now years later, they've passed away.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was at their funerals, too. And, yeah. We kind of kept missing each other, but I don't know if we've seen each other, but we never really hit it off and got something going. But here it is, the day that he comes to my studio with a big box of tapes, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, it's one of those convert VHS to DVD jobs, and I just thinking, oh, look at all these tapes. And then I look in the box, and we're actually talking about, well, maybe there's a story here. And I look in the box and I pull out the tape and I'm like, it's my tape that I sent all those years ago. And I said, well.
And that's how we made it, you know. It looks came like, full circle again.
It looks like we started on this thing 25 years ago.
Yeah. Well, you kind of did, really.
So.
But you, in the movie, kind of, especially near the end, you kind of put in a, I'll call it a curveball, but it was the spiritual dimension.
Yes.
About how things just don't really just sort of happen. Well, they do, but that there's a spiritual realm as to why it occurs.
There's been such a list. We had, you know, there's just so much stuff anyway that we couldn't put in here that was found out. But that is just crazy how crazy things have been happening.
Was this the first movie you've been in?
I've never done anything like this.
Right. I mean, yeah, Richard's a musician. He does a lot of recording, so.
Yeah, so that kind of fit hand in hand because I did, you know, I really compiled the entire soundtrack.
Right.
But original composition is probably about 2/3 of it. It was all original stuff.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned about how you kind of felt, I was running with this about, I'll call it the word alienation, but about how you were felt sort of out of sync. And then when they had the makeup, the latter funeral, the 21 years later funeral, about how you had long hair, you looked like a musician, and you were wondering how you were being received.
'80s wannabe rock star. Yeah.
Well, I think you talked about that spooky aspect of the movie.
Yeah, and I hope I didn't use that exact word, spooky.
No, it's spiritual.
Yeah,
there was definitely a bright, burning, guiding light somehow that kept us going in a direction. And the stuff that would just crisscross was just, you know, you just were taken back. And I to tell you the truth, as producer, I sit there, I even tear up watching the movie. It emotionally gets me.
Well, educate me, because I'm not really, and I should know, because my daughter is kind of in this business now. My daughter got into a couple of independent films, and she's an actor and singer. Anyway, I don't want to promote my daughter, but I'm not even sure exactly what a producer does, other than raises money for the film. Is that what the producer does?
Yeah, we finance the film ourselves.
Okay.
I think we're probably over $10,000 to put it together.
Easily.
We had to travel, and we scaled back as much as we could, and but that's, I have the equipment to edit, I shoot, and I started out as the director and producer, and soon I realized that this was Richard's story that he needs to tell, and all I had to do was, at his request, and keep both of us agreeing on the same lines, and we'd compromise back and forth as to where, what direction the film would need to go, or how things were too long, or I'd edit stuff, and then we'd toss that out and start again. So it was pretty much just me knowing how to produce or put together a film, and then him having a story that he needed to tell.
And once you decided that you were going to embark on this project together, how long did that take, basically, till the finished copy?
2.5 years.
Oh, really? That long?
Yeah. That's what I kept saying. Come on, Richard, let's do this.
Yeah, it was one of those things where, you know, you can always second guess everything, or you can always go, well, you know, well, maybe we should do this better. And that's, I think, a natural process. Right. And I only know that because, of the musician side of me.
Right.
You can always, sorry about that. You can always critique your stuff and always try to make it better, but you have to know when to cut it off. And Rudy, his experience during this whole thing is, that's kind of where his experience kind of lent me into a better realm, where, in other words, what parts should we use, what parts should we cut off,
right?
You know, but I think together we created a good song here, because we had to do the, you know, the continuity, the flow. You know, some things I wasn't sure if we should put in there, but the point that he brought together was making the story out of it. And what was the word there? The little pieces that take you away from the story all the time.
The MacGuffins.
The MacGuffins, okay? That was something that I was like, I've never heard of. But it made complete sense when you watched it back, because you don't want everybody, correct me if I'm wrong, Rudy, to get burnt out with the same, you know, facts and the and just the, right. the same storyline and everything. You have to have right. a little bit of break for your brain.
And you had an interesting part of the movie, the way it was put in between enactments and real footage. But we have right. I'll come back to that. I hope. We're trying to go to the phones. I believe we have a caller. Unless we...
Yeah.
Hello.
We're almost at him.
I heard a hello.
Guys, I saw the film.
There we go. You might want to start again. You just came on the air.
Sure, sure. I want to congratulate these two guys. I saw the film last night, and Rudy and Richard were a great team. I didn't realize it when I was watching it how much they collaborated until later. And I got to tell you, it's I have a lot to do with this film festival.
Oh, did you?
I got an award last year for writing, and I'm very involved with Del Vecchio and his crew. And I got to tell you, this was a film that should keep going because it was so important to me personally. But I think a lot of people saw it. It was so well done. I mean, Rudy and Richard were great collaborators, and like you said, the reenactments mixed in with the actual stock footage that Richard had it was beautifully done. Beautifully done.
I agree.
You know, I was very touched by it. I was very moved by it. I'm sure anybody who sees it would be this, you know, touched and moved also.
Right. And what's your name?
My name is John Bernary.
John, what's your role with the Hoboken Film Festival in?
Well, I was in. I'm very. I re-entered the showbiz world a little while ago. I mean, I used to be very involved in it back in the 80s, and I kind of gave it up to get a family. And I got back, and I got mixed up with Del Vecchio and his gang. I was in a number of his films. And
oh,
I was
really?
Just in the opening film that they did for Miracle, the Karate.
Right.
Karate Christmas Miracle I was in, and I'm also writing. I wrote a screenplay, an actual pilot, that won Best Pilot last year.
Oh, really?
And so I'm very, you know, into that genre of people like Rudy and Richard trying to, you know, make something stick. And it's a tough thing to do when you don't have, you know, all of that financial and all those powerful people in back of you. But when you keep going and when the cream just rises to the top, like these two guys' film is doing, that's really heartwarming. And I'm really all in their corner. Plus, I'm very, me personally, I mean, I was a survivor of 9/11. I worked at Windows on the World at the World Trade Center.
Oh, really?
as a captain. So when that went down, I freaked out. My son joined the Navy. We all freaked out. I really identified with a lot of things that you were saying.
Right. The film sort of integrated that idea too.
It did. Right. It did. And it really kind of that lit me up too, because you know, I felt responsible for my son going, and I was freaked out. My wife was freaked out, and then but then all of a sudden he became this big, giant, beautiful engineer now that's got this amazing job because he did go in.
John, what's your last name again?
Bernary, Bernieri, John Bernary. And so anyway, it was a very good, the film, I'm telling you, I mean, I'm not just saying this, I just met these guys last night. I see a lot of films, I know, since I'm a writer, I could tell about structure and all of that. What these guys put together was just amazing. I want to congratulate both of you guys.
Yeah, and so
thank
do
you,
I.
Sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Before you guys thank him, I want to say, you know, if there's a way, John, you could pass the word to Mr. Del Vecchio that at least you and I feel that these gentlemen should get an award for
I
their
did
efforts.
Already. What I did was, yeah. I did. I'm part of this.
It group, is a film festival where they pass
I'm part
out
of this
awards.
Facebook post group, and I posted a beautiful Facebook post about a small critique of the film already, and praising these guys. And I got a lot of hits on it. A lot of people are listening to me say what a great job they did. So, you know, and he reads it. Del Vecchio reads my Facebook stuff, and we talk back and forth. And like I said, he's become a pal because he's my fan, and I'm his fan. So, you know, he knows. He's going to know how I think. I mean,
I think I'm your fan now.
That's great. Well, I'm your fan, you guys. I mean, honestly, I wish you so much, and I know how hard it is to do stuff like this. It's so thankless, right? You hang out, do it, you mix it, you say, ooh, who's gonna care if I did this? But you know what? They're gonna care. I cared. So,
I cared too.
You know? Well,
good. As I think with this is my first time ever going around in the film side of it, and you know, that's where I take from Rudy's advice and experience. You know, I've been there with the music. It's kind of like the same thing, and I use this analogy all the time. You reach out to all these film festivals, and you know, there's always, you know, rejection is part of what you do, and you right. have to accept it, you know. And you also have to be picky about where you put it. You don't want to put your jazz tape at a heavy metal record label, you know, stuff like that. But there's something about this story that isn't just a, you know, a military thing. You know, it's more of a it's a human interest story. Right. And so I think it bridges a lot of gaps. So, but with that said, you know, you always have to just kind of don't worry about who doesn't want to take it in and just keep plugging away.
Right.
That's, you know, exactly, and right. Those were, you know, perfect words. You can't worry about what's going to happen. You just got to, you know, do it. Feel whatever you're compelled to do.
Exactly.
And yeah. do it. And that's what you guys did. And I'm telling you right now, I know it's going to pay off. I know, because it was a well done piece, you know. And I again, I'm very glad for you. I can't wait to see you at the awards thing.
Well, we'll be there
tomorrow. Yeah.
Awesome.
Thanks for calling, John. I appreciate it.
Okay, man.
Thanks, brother.
Bye-bye.
Now, you, what kind of music do you play?
Well, I guess by now it's a lot of different things. But I, you know, I did, I cut my teeth on the old 80s, you know, heavy metal stuff, and the hard rock, the guitar-oriented stuff. But now, you can even tell by listening to the film, I branch out everywhere. You know, right. I do a lot of different things.
Well, we branch out everywhere. That's why we have our sponsors to help us out.
Yeah,
that's like pragmatic thinking, right?
Yep.
So we'll be back right after this commercial message. We'll be right back. Stay tuned. And we're back. So, you know, another part of the movie that we were just mentioning off mic has to do with September 11th.
Yeah.
And other tragedies related to war, and how we didn't really spend enough time talking about
music.
It's going away.
Okay, there we go.
I'm kind of used to that one. That's like, I don't even, that one didn't faze me. Earlier it gave me a little bit of a rock, but not this one. No. So my secretary lost her husband September 11th. So and she's was raising
sorry to hear that.
three kids on her own. So the merging of emotions that were added in a way to the impact of the film that you guys put together has to do with the tragedies and the deaths of both events,
right.
about September 11th and other tragedies as well.
And what it does.
Plus the heroes that come out of it.
Right.
That's I guess what we were trying
now,
to
get. Now, the heroes, let's get into that, because your dad was a hero, and he was recognized as one. Maybe not as much as he should have, but after your film, one of the results might be a second look at this, but part of the reason why your dad wasn't earlier recognized for his contributions was because it was all special operations. It was all classified stuff.
Yep. And it's also back then the inner structure of all the units and stuff were different. They didn't necessarily have a person that would be always taking records. And nowadays everything's happening in real time anyway. So it's really completely different. But as the film clearly states, these gentlemen could give a rat's ass about medals.
Yeah, they
you know, and right. that's
they weren't looking for medals, right?
Right, and you know,
but I am. I'm looking
well,
for
that's,
them.
Well, that's exactly
and
right. And you know, this conversation has come up many, many times, and it is something. And a lot of these gentlemen, the last few times I've been at the special operations reunions, well, in the past few years at least. You know, they have been starting to get awards and that they've been deserved for a long time. And if you start to keep records about, you know, that's one thing I didn't get too detailed in the movie, but if you actually keep track and if you know of anything about how the medals work, he talks about the one bronze star.
Right.
Well, when you break it down and you start looking at the details, there should be another bronze star or at least a bronze star with a V device for valor. But there also should be a silver star in there.
Right.
And he's got two Purple Hearts, one for when he was killed, and one that they acknowledge the other Bronze Star.
Right.
That was for the other mission, that there's a letter home that he wrote about.
Right.
And so that, you know, I don't want to give too many details away about the movie. I'd like people to come and see it. But, you know, those are things that I've wrestled with. Do I, you know, do I make that a mission to get these medals, or, you know, what does it really mean? You know, do I need those medals? Do I need those medals on the wall? Or do I think about, you know, would he have rather just, listen, I'm doing this for the guys beside me. I'm doing this for my country. You know what I mean? It's something I wrestle with a lot,
yeah.
You know, but you know, I guess in the grand scheme, he does deserve the medals, but you know, let's break it down. It's a piece of metal on your wall, and it represents something. It doesn't bring him back.
Of course not.
So
of course not. But it kind of is a step towards justice too.
Yep.
Well, you know? Some of those stories that there's not records of those stories. I mean, we first took a letter from November of 68, which was probably days or weeks before he died.
Mm-hmm.
And when we interviewed Krause, a gentleman in South Dakota. He started telling of this mission, and then we looked at the letter and we're like, this is the letter, because he couldn't give details when he wrote home, because your mail was censored and everything. They didn't want information going out, but he gave enough details in there that we were able to listen to Krause's story and then put the two together. It was the same mission he was talking about.
Right. Yeah. Well, so, you know, I have a not quite as dramatic a story, but I have a personal story as well with my father. Part of the emotions for the movie for me, just because everybody comes into the theater with their own baggage and their own experiences,
of course,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
But my father, I was fairly young when my dad passed away. He was a World War II vet. And one of the stories that he would tell me, because I cherish each one of the stories that that he repeated, so I've incorporated into who I am.
Exactly.
Right. But I was listening to a friend of mine talk about his brother's father-in-law, and how his stories sounded remarkably similar to the stories I was telling my friend that my dad taught me. Right? Well, it turns out they were in the same airplane. the same B-17 bomber flying over to Europe together.
Wow.
I mean, isn't that...
That is crazy.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, what are the odds? You know?
Again, these things happen for a reason.
Yeah,
you
supernatural.
Know, it really is, you know?
And I got to speak to him for several hours, thank God, because his father-in-law, you know, of the friend, he passed away shortly after that. So I would have had him. You know, I almost missed that opportunity.
Mm-hmm. So for me, I don't mean to make that conversation about me, but I am. It's very nice to hear somebody in your situation that and recognizes the importance of those conversations and the information and the things that you got to experience. And you just said it. Thank God I got the. You know.
Right.
So coming from a situation like mine, you know. You're always yearning for that. It's
right.
always something that you always, you know, miss, and you're always thinking about, and what if, you know, and that's one of those minor things. And, you know, as it makes you, so that's what I've, you know, been yearning for, what's making me.
Right.
That's really what the question of this whole story is. And you know, how do I find out? How do I come into my own? How do I find out who I am? You know, and that's part of life.
Right.
As sons, you know, we always do that, you know.
Right.
So.
Well, making the movie itself was such a effort because of the fact there was no footage. Now, I take back, there was, James Shorten gave us this Special Forces training footage that he shot.
Right.
And it wasn't live action, but it was helicopter stuff. Mm-hmm. And we were able to show extractions and things like that. But... for the most part, there was no other footage because they just, along with the records, they didn't exist.
Right.
And so we went out and did this recreation. And
yeah, and in a nutshell, what was it, 12 soldiers with your dad?
Every mission was almost different.
Oh,
they had different, depends on what they needed.
But then when
they
got
the
surrounded at the...
that particular one was 12, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And all 12 get out, fighting 300 people.
Right.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
But one of the things I like to say about, and especially because we're at a film festival and people want to, you know, look at the acting. And when we did the soldiers, the special ops guys, these guys were stealth. and to film them how they really were, which was not moving and unseen.
Right.
We had to, like, you know, hey, walk out into this clearing and stuff like that.
Yeah, sort of
you had
poetic
to make it
license.
Use. You had to, you had to basically use what would work for the movie and the visual.
And I think that when we showed it to the special ops reunion folks,
they were on
okay.
board.
They were okay with. They know that for you know they. Were, I read some of their books and they would stay still for like 20, 30 minutes, maybe an hour, as they heard a snap of a twig somewhere and.
And their life depended on it.
Right. Yes.
So listen, we have, it's a 10 o'clock hour. Stay tuned. Stay with us, you guys. And we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Listen to our sponsors. And thanks for tuning in so far. And welcome back, folks. We're having some interesting off-mic conversations about Woodstock and about how the era, but also about, you know, the Vietnam War, the assassinations of Martin Luther King, civil rights movement, Bobby Kennedy. It was real tumultuous times. It really was. And, you know, I have a friend of mine, much younger than me. He's actually a religious guy. And through his church, they made a trip to Vietnam.
No kidding.
Yeah. And he came back. He was saying how friendly and every night and how nice the people of Vietnam were, and you know, I don't know that I'd be so friendly and nice, you know, but they are. They want to move forward, and they see America as kind of a hedge from the Chinese who are right next door.
Right.
So you get this colossal China right next to them, and Vietnam and China were never really bosom buddies to begin with. Interesting. Either one of you ever think about visiting Vietnam?
I think about it a lot. It's usually just I have a really interesting story. It's usually, you know, time, money, and this and that, running your own business, trying to be an adult, you know.
You got kids. And,
yeah, exactly. Right. You know, but I'll tell you a fairly moving story recently. I had a lady reach out to me on Facebook who was traveling to Laos. She had a POW MIA bracelet of a aviator who was still missing. And for some reason, she made it her declaration to just be interested, get involved, and go there, find the site, you know, just do all these things. She's a retired police lieutenant. Her husband just happens to be her ex-husband happens to be Special Forces. So she knows the world pretty well about this whole thing. But another friend of hers, before she went over, I do believe he was like one of the commanding a local post of the Vietnam Veterans of America, and she asked him, do you know anybody else from that area that maybe I should take a moment of silence for over there and all that? So he just so happened to know my father's story and have my father's bracelet, etc. So she reached out to me, and then she traveled to Laos and did all this, and you know. And as a matter of fact, she's putting together a screening down in North Carolina for us to do a little local thing for her. Anyway, so here's the craziest thing in the world. She had a couple that she knew. Actually, it was her partner on the police force. She knew him for, you know, 30-something years. She even retired, moved from Miami-Dade to North Carolina, and starts real estate agent business or whatever, hooks her old partner up to move with his wife all the way to North Carolina. All this stuff's going on. Well, this gentleman and his wife happen to be reading all the posts from her and from Laos and what's going on with, you know, me and this other thing. And I guess the guy made a post and he said, you know, this whole time I kept looking and going, where do I know that name from? Fitz, where do I know that name from? So in a long story short, he went back to his jewelry box. He had my father's bracelet the whole time.
Wow.
All 30 years, and they never connected.
Wow.
And then, yeah. So, I mean, it's just absolutely crazy.
I don't know much about... I mean, I pride myself on knowing what's going on in the world. I'm kind of the go-to guy in a lot of this stuff, but not on Laos. I can't say I know much of anything.
But so, you know, she's one that's made that homage. She said she's even going back. I actually was surprised. I got another offer. I was doing the Boston Wounded Vet Run, and somebody's been putting together a trip to go back in the next couple of years.
Well, I thought you guys would be interested in that as like a next chapter.
I would love to go.
There's a lot more to tell.
Right.
You know, we could literally make a whole week's worth of, you know, PBS show here.
So there is a part two.
Why not? Right. You know? There's a lot there, you know? You know, but you know, you don't commit anybody to do anything. You know what I mean?
Well, also,
our world is quite crazy. You know, we're busy with families.
But moving forward with what you have now, it's still part one, right?
Yeah.
I'm trying to suggest that you guys hook up with different veterans organizations for a showing of your film to add more publicity and attention to your efforts.
Well, that's actually kind of the thought process, correct? Rudy, when we first debuted this, we did it in Vegas at Special Operations Reunion this past October 2018. And, you know, Rudy, with his connections and everything, he had already, you can even tell the story of that. We got offered distribution while we were in the hotel.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah?
Not anything to do with what we were doing, but, you know, and he can fill in the details.
Yeah,
about that.
And there was, the thing was, it would take away, once it got aired, and they wanted to air it like on certain military channels. It was a cable distribution deal. And that would take away our right to screen at film festivals.
Oh.
And we wanted that grassroots to reach out to people and talk to people and come to visit you in the radio station, things like that.
Right.
This is what we really wanted to do. We didn't want to just put it out there and then have everyone forget it, you know, the day after Veterans Day, you know, just... We wanted to go out and touch people, you know, and so we turned it down.
Uh-huh.
And we're just, I guess we can revisit it again later, but, you know.
Yeah. Well, the other thing you might want to check out with different libraries.
Yeah, that's...
I know in Warwick, where we are right now, there's very strong Friends of the Library, great public mm-hmm. library. My hometown of Middletown has the best public library in the region. Just ask me. But there's different opportunities there for circulation of your film.
There's another venue that I've been really pushing lately, and it seems to start
community
to come
college.
Together.
Pardon me, community college as well.
Yeah. I've been just telling people that, listen, you know, if you are interested in, you know, setting up a screening or maybe like a dual event, I like to call it, to raise money for, you know, Gold Star families, military organizations, any veteran type thing. You know, we'd gladly do a screening like that to help, and we got to help ourselves out as well,
right?
You know, because there's money to involved in all of this. A lot of this came out of our pocket. However, to give back, to have this as a tool to give back and create events, which is another, in a way, it's kind of a good thing that it wasn't taken into distribution early, because my mentality would be, if that many people were able to see it on their cable, how many people would come and see at an event and raise money, you know? So I'd like to see something like that happen. And, you know, maybe screen the movie, after party,
right.
Sponsors, you know, split the proceeds, you know.
Finance your trip to Vietnam.
You know? Yeah.
That stuff too.
Part,
you know?
Two.
Well, how do they get a hold of you? How do people, if they want to watch the movie and they want you to have an event?
I do know, and bear with me because I am the worst with social media. You can reach out to Rudy. Do you want to give out any information
there's,
for you?
You can get the DVD for online for $15.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
And then $3 shipping, and it's on my website. And we don't really boast it too much. Like, again, we're really trying to get out there and screen for people.
Right.
But for people that are remote that may be here, if we don't not able to get back right away and you guys set something up here at your library, that's fine. It's on spirosvideo.com, and I have a merchandise page. So it's SPEROS video, Spiros Video, and .com. And then there's a merchandise page, and then you could just, you know, get a copy of it in DVD. We haven't put up it streaming or anything yet, and I know that's the way things are going, but
yeah,
like I said, we're just trying to keep it sort of contained, but it is available.
Yeah. One thing we don't want to keep contained is our sponsors, because I got the signal, and we appreciate them because they keep us going. So we'll be right back. WTBQ. And welcome back, folks. Here we are on WGHT, WTBQ. We got you double-barreled now. See, we still get that music, too. I have to just talk right around.
It's pretty hip.
It's something different, right?
Oh, to reiterate, too, one more way that you can follow this film, and again, bear with my social media ineptness, but my personal Facebook page has taken on a lot of that persona.
Okay.
But there's also a page, Staff Sergeant Richard A. Fitz documentary. So if you go to a Facebook page and just look that up, or just look up my name and you can follow it on Facebook.
Yeah. Well, that's easy. You can find if you have a commitment. Richard A. Fitz.
We're coming up in another film festival in the Washington, D.C. area.
Oh, yeah?
In June, North Beach American Film Festival. And so that's June 22nd, the weekend after Father's Day. So
okay.
That's Saturday.
I don't know if you know, there's a small one up in Sullivan County, up in Calicoon also, Narrowsburg. Just passing the word about the local scene.
Yeah, and actually we've been a few other places. We've been to Tupelo.
Yeah.
And Georgia, Atlanta. And California.
Yeah. Well, you need Boston.
Well, we
need Massachusetts.
We had a screening for the AMC Boston Globe.
Boston Globe got behind us, yes.
And we actually screened it on the big screen. So that was pretty cool.
In November, yeah that was great.
That was really cool.
Yeah, they really liked the story up there. It's
it's local, too.
It's close.
Right. Yeah, I can tell by the accents and,
Right, exactly.
Yeah, I kind of, when we first...
Accents, what accents? Yeah.
When I first did the movie, I know it's a local interest story, but then I thought, well, how well would it be received outside of that area? And one of our first screening was in Ocean City, Maryland,
right,
at the film festival, and we were the runner-up to the best film.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And that was an unfinished version.
Yeah.
I was cringing when he told me he was, going to put it down there. I'm like, what? No.
Well, I got to make sure I have Del Vecchio's email. I got to make sure I vote.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm allowed to vote, but I'll vote anyway.
You went and watched a movie, so I would...
Makes me an expert.
Yeah, well...
Well, that would make sense,
Yeah. So, we've had a lot of success so far, and we're still working at it, and we got a long, hard road to go, but it was a labor of love.
You also have done rock videos,
say,
right?
Yeah, I have... four other rock and roll documentaries I've done. My first one was Heavy Metal Picnic, and then I did one, Tension 25 Years Underground, and then I've just completed a two-part thing. One was 1984, Riding Into Hell, and then it was followed up this year, actually, with 1985, Indestructible. And the thing was, I was in the 80s, I had a video camera, and I was shooting footage of rock and roll metal bands, And I went and found the old band members and got contemporary interviews with them and weaved it all together and with the studio master tapes and things. And it's really cool. It's very politically incorrect, but I actually had Richard as a executive producer on my 1985 because I felt that the two of us working together and butting heads as we do, we create such.
You guys
a,
left that part out.
Yeah, well, it's no, part of the given ebb and flow of the
productive
whole thing.
Energy.
And
it's a different world for both of us too, though. Not to take away from his conversation about his movie, but it really is like I'm not going to say he's set in his ways, but that's how he worked for a long time, and I may be wrong, but I don't recall too many people that you've actually worked with that closely.
No,
Right. So as with anything, I had strong opinions about my story because it was so personal to me. And there's also certain things that I knew should have been conveyed a certain way. And I think both of us learned from it, but we're able to work through it. And that's the key.
Right.
You know what I mean?
So
we're not haters. We're not, we were able to work through it. There was a lot of passion and a lot of stuff going on at the time. But, sometimes that works better,
Right.
So. I think you feel that kind of passion in the final product.
Yes.
Because when you get people that collaborate like that, that are just sort of button heads, they're just getting the best out of each other.
Right. Well, that word passion was the one I was going to bring up, actually. So is your filmmaking your passion, or do you have another job too, or how does that work?
Well, we all have to make money, so the making the films is just a passion I have.
Not just.
Yeah.
No, that's why I use the word passion.
Yeah. Because
you can't say just with passion.
No,
it's a huge motivator, right?
I've been with Amtrak for 40 years.
Oh, okay.
So I'm a year and a half from retirement, and I can finally do exactly what I want to do. Uh-huh. And along with the films, I actually produce boxing programs.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And
Well, I'm a fan.
I've been doing that for 25 years. That's where I can make money in video production. And I just did a show in North Dakota, and I'll go out there as a producer and direct all the cameras and get graphics and music and tie it all together, and we do a tape delayed show, and it airs on. I'm having a meeting with the Sports Network of New York on Wednesday. So we have been on there before. I have done a show called Ballroom Boxing for 10 years, and now I'm doing a show called Ringside Boxing. So,
well, we're going to talk off mic because I'm curious about all this. But have you recorded your music?
I do have some stuff, yeah. I have a couple of things.
You play in a band or by yourself?
Not right now. That's something when I get the time, I'm going to look back into. I have a whole project idea right now that I'm actually starting to work on. But I had a recording project, some old, like the very first kids I ever played with in front of an audience in like freshman year or some silly thing like that, did a talent show. Those same three people we got together over 30 years later, had never played, and we ended up putting a friend of ours on vocals, who happens to, you know, work with a national recording artist. And we threw three songs together just on a whim. Right. And we left a lot of stuff on the table, but everybody's lives went the other way. Right. I was starting on this, you know, this project, so it took a lot of time away. But right now, I actually have an idea. Some of what Rudy and I have been doing, we've gotten a couple little interests and hits and asking if, you know, hey, would you be interested in maybe doing some music for my project or this or that? So I've really kind of started focusing a little bit different on what I'm doing. You know, I have my own business that I'm trying to keep afloat and this and that. So now I've kind of looked at my basement as my studio.
Right.
So now I have all these ideas, and if people want music, I'm going to go back in the archive. So all my original projects I've had in the past, I'm going to pick out two or three songs and re-record them and bring fresh light. So that's my latest project idea.
And is that your business idea too? That you?
No, I actually own a furniture restoration company.
Oh, okay.
And I've been doing furniture for 30 plus years now. Maybe not quite 30, 28. But I've been involved with that. So I had an opportunity to buy a place that was 4 miles from my house. And so I'm, you know, that's basically my second house. I live there constantly. It was me and another partner. So,
and you have, what, two kids?
I have, I have a stepson and a stepdaughter. Technically, we're not married, but, you know, we've been together for so long. But I have one son from previous marriage, and he's 20 years old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And how about you, Bob?
I have four daughters, and they're almost hitting that point where they'll all be teenagers at one time, 19 through 13.
Lucky you, man.
Yeah, so it was great to get away and come all the way out of here to Greenwood Lake and away from the kids for a little bit. So they couldn't come with us because they're still in school.
Yeah.
But, I just want to say one thing. The music that Richard produced for this documentary, I think, is superb, and it really gets the mood going. And when I finished off my 1985, I went to him and I asked him for some pieces of music that I could use, and they just went... He enhanced my other production so much just by the musical input that he gave me. And it just, I've gotten nothing but positive feedback about the movie. And it has played in two film festivals. Mm-hmm. And if it still qualifies, I'm probably going to enter it down here in Hoboken for next year, the 1985 Indestructible. So we'll see.
Well, best of luck with that.
More stuff to hear from us.
Yeah.
It's nice to hear you guys exchange your confidence and respect for each other. I mean, it comes through. Right. Also, you red flagged it. Every once in a while, you don't agree, and you kind of like let each other know about it. But that's also part of the human condition, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know? So it's a collaboration. And and even though we only have a couple of minutes left, I'll repeat myself in saying that your movie, your project, was really moving. Mm-hmm. And it had a big impact. My wife and I were talking about it as we're riding back with all the, I'll call them sub themes, but father mm-hmm. and son,
right?
Justice for valor, patriotism, which I don't know that we even mentioned the word, but it's
yeah.
It should be infused with all of it. and
grief, grief tying in with the whole thing,
right? And then the technical aspect of merging the planned with the unplanned, and the stealthness, and I mean, there's a lot going on. There's a lot going on in that movie.
Yeah, I think that part of it kind of made it a little tough to be able to make the continuity in the story. Because that's what I mean. Like, Rudy, I'm sure, and correct me if I'm wrong, I say this all the time. A lot of people start off with a script. They kind of have either a timeline to go by, right, or some type of script. And in this case, it wasn't really possible. It had to be created as we went.
Yeah. We didn't know where the timeline was going to end up or which direction it would take us, so... But I just want to make sure that people do know there is a trailer on YouTube.
Yes.
That all you do is look up 21 Years of Folded Flag.
Well, what are you looking at?
On YouTube. It's 21 Years, the numbers, 2 and 1, and then a Folded Flag. 21 Years of Folded Flag.
So, there you go. Yep.
I just hope you all take time to check it out, folks. And keep me posted what goes on in your D.C. Film Festival.
Oh, yeah.
And I want to talk to you about boxing, too. And you got to keep me up with your music, you know?
Sure, sure.
So I want to thank you and your dad's memory.
Thank
your
you.
Dad for his service to our country. And to all the other Vietnam-era veterans, some of which I had the honor to know myself. And I'm glad you guys made it into the studio today.
Yeah, more than honored. Thank you. Appreciate
thank
it.
You.
Yeah,
appreciate
we're going to get Del Vecchio to pay attention now.
This thing on? Tap, tap.
All right, folks. See you next week.
Thank
Jeff
you.
Berkman signing off.
Thank you.